back, this topic, the articulations of the spine, seems to be a very small discussion, and sometimes we feel it to be avoided. But that's not so, because this topic is very important with respect to your practical and your academic life. If it is to the academic, you might be asked about the interbody joints for FEMRs or a short note question. Sometimes even the psychoapophyseal joints. But what about the practical life? What about our professional life? We see or we come across patients having problems with the facet joints. We see that there are facet joint pathologies. We go for spine mobilization techniques like Mulligan's mobilization, etc. At all those times, we need to have a thorough understanding about how different bones, how different vertebrae are joined in the spine. And that can be done only by having a proper understanding about the psychoapophyseal joints as well as the interbody joints. Now we discuss about the interbody joints and psychoapophyseal joints in this video. One is the interbody joints. We know that there are different type of joints like fibrous joints, cartilaginous joint and synovial joint. What type of joint is the interbody joints? The interbody joints are not synovial, but they are cartilaginous joint. They are cartilaginous joint. What type of cartilaginous joint? They are the symphysis type of cartilaginous joint. Symphysis type of cartilaginous joint. This might be asked in various MCQs. What type of joint is the interbody joint? They are symphysis type of cartilaginous joint. Symphysis means, you know, that there are some disc or pads in between different bony joints, and there is a loose packed hyaline cartilage. The opposite of is a synchondrosis joint, which we might discuss later. So interbody joints are cartilaginous joints of the symphysis type. So what do you mean by interbody joint? We have two vertebrae over here, right? So this is the first one, this is the second one. For example, you call this is a fourth vertebra and this is a fifth one. Okay. Now, when this both vertebra articulates together, this joint between the body of the vertebra is known as interbody joints. It's so simple from the word itself. The joints between the body of the vertebra is known as interbody joints. And they have the pad or the menis disc between them. They have an associated structure. That's why they are the cartilaginous joint. That is the disc between them. So the joint between two adjacent bodies of the vertebra is known as the interbody joints, and it also includes the disc in between them. Okay, so that is the interbody joints. Now every vertebra has an interbody joints, like T1 has to T2, T1 has with C7, etc. Now when you look at the interbody joint, disc in between them, now there are different type of motions about the interbody joints. Can you just tell me what are the motions possible in this interbody joint? To understand the motions, we need to understand which are the possible sites of movement of this vertebra. For example, this vertebra can move anteriorly like this, slightly anterior and posterior like this. So that is a translatory motion. So the first motion can be translatory motions. How many translations can be possible? You can see that this vertebra can slightly translate anterior, slightly translate posterior. So this is the first motion, anterior and posterior translation. This vertebra can also translate towards side. See, medial and lateral translation, slightly to the side and to the side, medial and lateral translation, right? To understand this, I'm just demonstrating it with the help of the disc in between this vertebra. For example, yeah, this is not actually the disc, but instead I just borrowed it from my mother. She was preparing for the night chapati, right? Okay, now you want to understand the anterior and posterior translations. You can just see that this is how the anterior and posterior translation takes place, and now this is how the medial and lateral translation takes place. That's about the translatory motions: anterior, posterior, medial, lateral. Okay, now there are also other motions. For example, I can compress it from here to here like this. Okay, this is the compression. I can also distract it. For example, going for some sort of movements like then it can get distracted also. It can get distracted like this. So this is the compression, and exactly opposite to that is the distraction. Now we got how many movements? 4 movements. Then there is a tilting movement. For example, you can see, just look at this one. Okay, this is the normal shape of that disc. Now when the vertebra is tilting like this, this is the anterior tilting movement. You can see that. What is the shape of the vertebra? It becomes a tilted, right? It becomes tilted. This is the anterior tilt. And now again back to the normal. This is not the normal disc, so it won't get deformed itself. We have to do it. Now, when it is moving backwards like this, see? When it is moving backwards like this, this is the posterior tilt of the vertebra. So this is the anterior tilt. This is the posterior tilt. Anterior tilt, posterior tilt. Anterior tilt, posterior tilt. So how many movements we saw? Anterior and posterior translation, medial and lateral translation, anterior tilt and posterior tilt, right? Then it also can have compression as well as distraction. And then one more movement is the axial rotation. It can rotate in this axis like this. It can rotate in this axis like this. It can rotate in this axis like this. Clear? So that is the axial rotation. So how many possible movements have you seen? How many motions have we seen? We have seen anterior posterior translation, medial lateral translation, we have seen axial rotation, we have seen compression, distraction. That makes the 4 movements. Then there is also a movement known as anterior tilt, posterior tilt. Similarly, the vertebra can also tilt to the sideways. If it is tilting, for example, like the lateral flexion, it is tilting sideways. That is known as the sideways tilt. So it can have sideways tilt. All together, there are 6 degree of freedom. Can you just repeat with me? Which are the anterior posterior translation, medial lateral translation, anterior tilt, posterior tilt, lateral tilt to both sides, and compression, distraction. And finally, the last rotation, axial rotation. So these are the degrees of freedom that you can see in the interbody joints. Now, the degrees of freedom, or the freedom of the interbody joints, or the extent of the motion, can differ. It can differ with respect to various other factors, like the psychoapophyseal joints can contribute to it, or due to the variation between different regions in the vertebra. For example, in the cervical region, the motion will be different from the thoracic and lumbar region. The extent of the motion also will be different. We will see that later when we discuss into each and every region of the vertebral column. Now let us go on to the next topic, that is the psychoapophyseal joints. What are psychoapophyseal joints? I told you earlier, every vertebra has 2 superior articular facet and 2 inferior articular facet. This vertebra also has 2 superior articular facet, 2 inferior articular facet. So what are psychoapophyseal joints? Psychoapophyseal joints are seen in right side and left side. For example, this is a vertebra above. This vertebra's inferior articular facet is articulating with the lower vertebra's superior articular facet like this. Okay, lower vertebra's superior articular facet. So this becomes the psychoapophyseal joint of the right side. This becomes the psychoapophyseal joint of the left side. And they are what type of joint? Synovial joints. They are what type of joint? They are synovial joints. If they are synovial joints, they will have the capsule. So psychoapophyseal capsule. They have the psychoapophyseal capsule. Okay, so they are what type of joint? They are synovial joints. So they have a capsule. The synovial joint can also have some structures like meniscoids, etc. We have seen in the knee joint, we have seen labrum and other associated structure can be seen. Okay, so finally conclude that there can be some associated structures like meniscoids, etc., or meniscoids, etc., in this psychoapophyseal joint. Okay, so what are psychoapophyseal joints? The vertebral joints, the joints in the vertebra that articulates the superior articular facet of the vertebra with the inferior articular facet. How many psychoapophyseal can be seen? Right side we have psychoapophyseal joint, left side also we have psychoapophyseal. Superior also is that, inferior also is that. So if you say the superior articular facet of one vertebra articulates with the inferior articular facet of the another vertebra, these two joints either in the right side and in the left side becomes the psychoapophyseal joint. Now if you look at the psychoapophyseal joint, can you just See that its shape of the zygapophyseal joint. The shape of the zygapophyseal joint can vary between different regions of the vertebra. For example, in other regions, like see here, the zygapophyseal joint, a relatively flat one. Here it is like a relatively biconcave structure. So here, different regions of the vertebral column, we can see the zygapophyseal joints having different regions, different regional variations or shape. So what are zygapophyseal joint? These are the articular facet joints that are seen in the vertebra. They articulate the superior articular facets, superior articular facet of one vertebra with the inferior articular facet of the lower vertebra in right side and left side. So we have it the zygapophyseal joint. So you have to mention that there is in the right side there is zygapophyseal joint, in the left side also there are zygapophyseal. So these are the conclusion about the articulations of the spine, where we discussed about interbody joints and zygapophyseal joint. These are very important, and there are sometimes there are sometimes restriction in motion with the zygapophyseal joint, and then it relates to facet joint. These zygapophyseal joints are also known as facet joints. So then we have the condition known as facet joint pathologies, facet joint disarticulation, facet joint movement problems. Then of course we can try different mobilization technique like Mulligan's mobilization, McKenzie, etc., and get better results in that. Okay, so for that we need to identify the zygapophyseal joint. Disarticulations or improper kinematic movement between zygapophyseal joints are very common reason, very commonly seen, and they are one of the reason for back pain, etc. So see you in the next video, where we discuss about the ligaments of the spine, which are very important. Until then, stay tuned, and if you like the video, don't forget to click the like button.